online.
Hi, everyone. I'm Michelle from India, and I represent an organization called Tamarind Tree. We've been working for the last 8 to 10 years on redefining elementary education in India, basically using open source technologies. And I have about 20 minutes to share our work with Moodle and other open source tools in a large country like India, and particularly what we've been doing in the last 3 months with the pandemic. So just to give you a little background, we are located in a small tribal hamlet in northwest Maharashtra, where we run a school for the local indigenous children, which runs from, you know, kindergarten to grade 10. And the only reason, I mean, one of the main reasons we were drawn to using technologies is that we believe strongly that it's only through open source technologies that education can really change. So our idea is to break the classroom structures, break hierarchies, build collaborative learning. These were some of the things that we desired to do and put before the society a model of open digital education. For the last 10 years, we now have a model in place at the ground level where the school runs on open hardware, open software, open content. It's driven by the Moodle LMS. We do use the virtual class platform like BigBlueButton. For hardware, we use single board computers like the Raspberry Pi. And our children, who are all first generation learners who don't have a book to read at home, learn using these open source technologies. So we've been establishing to the world in a country that's, you know, fairly ambivalent about the use of technology with young children, that young children, and that too children from a marginalized background, can learn using open source technologies. The reason we are committed to Moodle is predominantly because Moodle, BigBlueButton, H5P, Creative Commons, these are all the politically right open source technologies where knowledge is free, the codes are free, and people can adapt, reuse, remix, and, you know, collaborate to build this kind of a world. So we are deeply committed to open source. Our children have never used anything proprietary, and we continue that model. As you are all aware, or some of you may not be aware, but the situation in India with public education is pretty dismal. A lot of children are still out of school. The model of education that India follows, whether through public education or through private education, is largely rote learning, exam driven, grade oriented, not concept and knowledge driven. And often children are, you know, pass out of the system, 15, 18 years of the system, with very little skills or knowledge. We've been saying for the last so many years that, you know, the textbook, the teacher, and the blackboard have all become irrelevant, and we need to put in place new methods of learning, new methods of teaching. In our case, the location where we are at, and particularly in India, for the marginalized communities, it's even further accentuated because there's intergenerational inequity with learning, and even basic learning levels of English and maths have not been achieved with these traditional forms of teaching and learning. So as an organization, we are basically here to address the issue of poor quality education, and we use a lot of open source technologies for this. As I said, so at the ground level, we run a completely open education model where we have about 125 learners. We research, we customize, we harness a lot of the open digital educational resources released globally, whether it's Moodle or it's, you know, as the other packages that go along with it. And we customize our courses, train our teachers to build their own content, and, you know, conduct all our learning and teaching only in the open domain. We've launched our entire Moodle instance is on MyBig campus. Along with that, we even prior to the pandemic, we were using the virtual class platform, and we've been building openly licensed courses and content and releasing these in the public domain. We also, you know, build e-libraries. We have our own operating system, which we encourage other rural schools as well as public schools to use, which is a derivative of Debian. So we offer an entire sort of a range of open learning products and solutions. all our open education work is being catered to and driven to the age group of 6 to 16 years, primarily in areas which are under-resourced, where the children are having a very poor quality education. And we strongly believe that for a country like India, open education is the only way to build equity. The country is increasingly being dependent on profit-making edtech companies to build solutions, but this is not going to be accessible to the largely poor and underprivileged children of our country. So we are advocates of open education, we push for open education, and we also customize and provide solutions for open education. Now, what has been happening all these years is that often people found it unbelievable that you're using so much of technology with very young children, 6, 7, 8, and that too from a marginalized background. In March, when India went into lockdown, ironically, the pandemic proved to be a huge kind of a opportunity for people like us who have been pushing for open education for the last 8 to 10 years. So what we did is that we used this time to release our platforms, which is the Moodle platform, Pan India. We offered all our primary and elementary courses free and open to any child in any part of India. And we also launched a volunteer program telling people that, learning and teaching is no longer about formal curriculum, formal syllabus. If you are passionate, you have something to say to children, you would like to engage with them, and you'd like to create, some sort of a magic online why your engagement, join us. And we could see around us that, teachers are rushing in to use a set of tools. There is no political context of which tool I should use, why I should use this tool, which platform a school or an institution can set up. And, India is still there in terms of its own usage of open education resources. Educators are still very skeptical. There have been several, orders passed in the last 3 months that, very young children shouldn't be put online. There have been bans. There have been all sorts of things. In this entire mess, we've been slowly building a school without walls, where we've got volunteers who come in with us. We've got children who we've never met before, Pan India, who just register on our site. And we've got a series of courses that we've been, offering. And we've been pushing for every volunteer to use open education. We've been demonstrating that, it's all about creating that magic on your own online. It's about creating your own content. It's about creating your own videos. And we've spent a lot of time in the last 3 months then understanding what it would mean to become an online teacher or to become an online facilitator. And it's been interesting because we offered programs both which are curriculum driven by the Indian curriculum, as well as very generic courses on, photography using your mobile camera or financial literacy. And obviously, once, children are coming online and the structure of the school or the structure of the institution is broken, children need to be coming as self-motivated learners who really want to learn that math or really want to learn that science. And what's been missing in the entire education, ecosystem for the last several hundreds of years is that children are just put into institutions and, said that this is how you have to learn and this is what you have to learn. And online learning simply doesn't work like that. So we've been working with our volunteers to, to build up an environment that you need to be a mentor, where the child is genuinely inspired by what you have to say. You have to come online with something that you are passionate about. And then over and above that, we've been training volunteers to actually build their own content using Moodle, use platforms like Big Blue Button to conduct their synchronous classes, as well as build offline asynchronous digital content. People have been very resistant to building their own content. Often people just want to take ready videos or don't want the pains to actually learn how to set up an assignment or a forum discussion or a quiz, believing that someone else is always an expert in this and I'm not really good enough. So we've been encouraging a DIY culture, and we've been encouraging an open culture. And, we've had some very, very interesting and, phenomenal experiences. We've also been telling people that, at the end of the day, it's not the platform or it's not the tool or the technology that counts. We strongly believe that we need to be owners of our platforms and technologies, which we have in our case, Overcome. We use everything open and we've got all our digital infrastructure in place. But at at the end of the day, when you're online and, you know, when you're developing these courses and when you're building educational interaction, it's the pedagogy that counts. Whether you were in a classroom or now you're online, what is it that you can do that can get, that can inspire, that can create a collaborative learning space, that can build on somebody's knowledge, and that can ensure that the child comes back to your class? So we've been building systems, we've been building, you know, templates for teachers and online volunteers. And over time, we a lot of people drop out of the program because we simply don't accept, ready content or just delivery from the textbook, because this is exactly what we've been trying to dismantle all these years. And for us, the entire usage of the open source platforms are just the path. That's just the technology. Changing education is still a large sociological project. And now the entire tools have changed. The thinking have changed. The children coming onto the platform has changed. How is it that we can actually do something different? In order for us to actually do something different, we're going to have to throw out, dismantle, and, you know, really reject what has been done in the past. And this is the time consuming work, whether it's volunteers who are, you know, coming absolutely fresh, or it's teachers who are now expected to suddenly come online and, you know, deliver the same kind of thing they're delivering, but in a completely different atmosphere. So, the lockdown has opened up for us children who we would have always liked to meet in the past, but were never able to establish that, you know, digital online learning is possible. A six-year-old sitting, you know, 1,000 kilometers away from where we are is today coming on our platform. An adult volunteer sitting in, you know, the UK, for instance, is now taking class with Indian children, working with us, developing pedagogy, understanding open source tools, learning new tools. And it's been a really exciting experience in that sense. We've done more than 2,200 hours of teaching. We've had more than 20 odd courses that we've actually been able to implement, and we've had more than 50 volunteers. So this is just a sort of a brief, overview of how we were able to use every open platform that's available, right from Moodle to Big Blue Button to all our content, which is built within the core of Moodle, or adds things like H5P to really put our courses forward. However, the work that needs to be done in a country like India is huge. Every day we see edtech companies coming up with solutions, some of them offering it completely free not in terms of ownership, obviously, but free in terms of use. And the overall political education of teachers in India to differentiate between what is open and what is not, and why open is the correct thing because education is a social good, is still a long, long way to go. The OER movement is picking up in India, but at the end of the day, it's the dominant work is still being done by the proprietary edtech companies. There is a great need in India to push for open education, to push for platforms like Moodle integrated with all the other open source applications and tools for children in India. And we are a dot in the ocean. It's a very large country, and often convincing people why open is important or why an LMS like Moodle can do wonders for your institutions is the larger struggle. We continue, using our open platforms, and we continue, pushing for it. So, in the lockdown, we've had a wide range of children from across India who have, a lot of these come from the state we are in, which is Maharashtra, because we are kind of known in this state. But we've had children from all across the country, and in that sense it's been and we're continuing to build a platform like this that can be open, that can be free at all given points of time, where children from 6 years to 16 years can access use open source courses, use content that is in the open source, and really we're working to build an open education movement in India. didn't prepare for longer than 20 minutes, and I think I finished in 15. But I would be available for comments on the forum. You can, you know, post your questions, and we can share some of our, you know, struggles and journey in building this open education movement. Tamarind Tree in India is probably one of the only schools that uses or that is built entirely on open on the open source model, using Moodle and the other you know, platforms. And it has been a very long journey, and a lot more needs to be done in the years ahead. So I look forward to your questions coming through the forum, and I'm available throughout the 5 days. Would be fun to get in touch and share some ideas. Thank you.
All right, we have one question from the forums. Thanks very much for that presentation. The question was from Dan McGuire. It's, I'm curious to know how much of the content from the 22 courses is openly licensed, and how one could get copies of that openly licensed content if it is available.
Yeah, so Dan, right now, I mean, it's all openly licensed. All our courses are in the Moodle instance, which is hosted at mybigcampus.in, and we could give you a login and you could take it, or we could download it and, you know, upload it into your Moodle instance if you like. There's science and maths driven courses largely, but there's also English. And yeah, I mean, we could use them. They've been basically used, created for grades 1 to 8. So they're all openly licensed. I mean, right now they're still embedded within our ecosystem, within the Moodle instance, but a lot of the resources could be released freely. Yeah.
All right. I don't think we have any other questions. Michelle, thank you very much for your presentation. That was fantastic. We're now going to have a short coffee break before the next presentation in here, which is Power to the Learner, presenting an online learning arrangement from the student's point of view by Christine Dufler. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you.